One thing about Toto, you know, from the very beginning, is that it's a band of virtuoso musicians.
You get on the stage with Steve Lukather, David Paich, you just gotta bring your A game. This is not average talent, by no means. These guys are monsters.
Toto is a musician's band.
This is our version of Toto, to keep the music alive. We're gonna play solo stuff too. We really try to draw a line in the sand from the past to what we're doing in the future, which is part of the reason we did the live stream. We're starting fresh. As the greatest homage to the people that have ever been in the band.
To the end, your name will touch my lips like prayer.
I'm David Paich, and I play keyboard.
Meet you all the way.
Hello, my name is Joseph Williams, and I play the voice.
Hey, this is Steve Lukather.
I mean, he's one of the greatest guitar players God ever made, as far as I'm concerned.
I'm Dominique Xavier. I play keys and piano.
I'm John Pierce, and I'm the latest bass player in town.
My name is Robert Sput, Searight, and I play drums.
Sput is a force of nature.
I'm Steve Maggiora, and I play keyboards and sing background.
Hi, I'm Warren Hamm, and I'm the sax player, flute, and percussionist. I also play harmonica and sing as well.
We've decided to really to give it one last. Let's put the band together one last time. You know what I mean?
One more time.
Yeah, I got a call from Luke. And I was like, oh shit.
We chose the new band based upon recommendation.
It seemed like a puzzle. It fit, everything fit.
And an opportunity like Toto is equivalent, you know, to an opportunity like Prince for most musicians. And so I had a beautiful time.
It's just, it's a tighter, more coherent unit than perhaps the last one in terms of just the sound and the members. We're going out leaner, a little tighter. You know that kind.
It's a different vibe, man. It's, you know, this band has morphed so many times.
In this band, these guys are really good musicians. The whole band. I mean, I've never been in a band with this much talent.
One thing, one transitional like piece in this whole thing that really made me happy is that I got to uphold this bar of musicianship, you know, by going from Prince to Toto. There's just this level of musicianship that you're expected of and that you have to bring every performance, every recording.
Very fortunate that I've been able to work with, play with the very best musicians, and producers, and engineers and on the planet, so I've learned a lot. I've been privy to, you know, because people want to play with us, because it's a legacy band or whatever the band is, and we have always had a reputation of having great musicians, whether you like the music or not, you know. We were so into it, it was really inspiring for me and Joe to be inspired by guys that were like, this is fun for them to play this stuff because it's the first time they played it. They haven't been playing it for 45 years or whatever.
First of all my guitar player friends think Luke is God. You know, he's a guitar god.
Anytime you look up any of your favorite songs, he's probably playing on it.
He's been a fixture in my life as long as I can recall.
Luke came up to me and we were taking a break, and he was like, came up and put his arm around me. He was like, hey man, you can relax now. You got the gig.
It didn't really hit me until once we got here and started rehearsing. And I was like, wow, it's kind of a dream.
There's many levels that the role, my role, has evolved to here, which is being the MD for the band now, which doesn't really need an MD, but I'm there because I know the music inside and out, and I can, again, fine-tune it. And our music is about the details.
You know, from the first day of rehearsal, I came in just on it. And I tried my hardest to earn their respect in that regard. And I think that it worked and to the way to where they gave me liberties, you know, during the show.
Walking in, meeting everybody for the first time, meeting Sput, meeting X, meeting Warren, meeting John, Luke and Joe came in and we just kind of started. And it was just, okay, cool, this tune, yeah. Sput, kick it off, and just right into it. And that was such an incredible feeling. Love me when I
call your name, yeah, yeah. Steve was on it when he showed up.
He's, you know, two-handed guy. It's almost like he's got a third hand in there somewhere. Such a card game. Whoa. The basic idea is that each new guy, you know, brings their own thing to it and stuff, and that they're not just, you know, people to sound like or replace
previous people.
We didn't
audition a bunch of people, in other words. We knew exactly who we wanted to, you know.
And it wasn't hard to locate.
My first interaction with joining Toto was warm, funny, and just golden.
The way that we differentiate the parts, X is covering most of the David Paich parts, and I'm covering most of the Steve Picaro parts. So I'm doing a lot of synth stuff and doubling of horns with Warren.
When you're actually doing it, you go, wow, I wonder, how is this gonna translate? How is this gonna, you know, be received?
There are musical arrangements were very intricate. And so this new band, it takes a very much pride in devoting itself to details, which bring out the passion to me in the music.
Okay, these guys make sense on paper. Let's see what it sounds like. Let's see if we all get on as people, as personalities, because half the gig is you gotta hang out with these people.
I would say the things about the new band that has in common with the original band is that how quickly the music came together.
They're all really, really good.
I was blessed enough to be in this group of guys that pay attention to musicianship and that celebrate it and culture it in a way that can be presented to its fans in the right way, rather than suppress it and make you feel less than.
You know, when I walked in a couple days after they started rehearsing, and they had the whole set down, unbelievably, you know. And that's quite a feat to master our set in that amount of time, being new players to it.
If you like the records, you're gonna love the live versions of these songs.
Everybody who's been in the band at one point or another has all been legendary, wonderful, soulful people that we adore and have been part of our family, so thank you to everybody.
I think Luke really trusted his gut on a lot of the decisions made for this new band. He was just like, well, I think it should go this way, and this is how we're going to do it. And so it's turning out to work out really fine.
When you start out playing with Jeff Picaro as the drummer, you know, Mike Picaro on bass or whatever, you know, you play with these level of musicians, you got to get people at least close.
It was like, you know, we can train anybody to cover the parts, but we really want to make sure that, you know, we can be on the road with you for, you know, year after year after year.
Now, musically, we knew everybody was capable, but, you know, sometimes you throw a gumbo together and it tastes good and sometimes it's a mess. So I think it's the first time we got through the set, you know, and I realized that, like, this is gonna work.
It boggles the mind to think that we'd still be going now and there would be permutations of the band and people would still be playing our music at this time. I've been made the MD, which is called the musical director.
At this point, I mean, it's still his band, you know, but, you know, he's handed me the wheel because he can't physically drive.
It was like having the perfect musical director, you know, MD. He was the perfect guy to do this job.
Dave is Toto, you know, and just having him there just made it feel like real Toto.
As a keyboardist, you know, there's very few people in the world that know how to correctly place keyboards in rock music. David Paich and Steve Carl are those people that know how to do that.
It's just fine-tuning little things here. When you hear a balance, when you hear a vocal part that maybe needs to switch persons, this person needs to sing higher, or this person needs to sing lower, or a keyboard nuance here, inversion is wrong. So I would say, hey, instead of playing out your left hand there, play your left hand up here and double that in octaves up here. Just small, minute suggestions, because I already had it pretty much together. But that's where I can step back again and listen from a different perspective and fine tune it, you know, which is a music director's dream come true, is to have a band that's so together, you just get to do the fine tuning of it, which isn't much, you know?
Luke hears it, he just knows something is, that ain't right. But David actually can tell you exactly what you're doing wrong or why it needs to change or whatever. And so it was kind of cool to hear David walk over to me and tell me like the reason why Jeff was playing some of these drum parts that I was thinking were fills, but they were actually drum parts.
He's still very much part of the decision-making process, and you know, he'd come down and fix people's vocal parts or fix a voicing on the keyboards and offer suggestions for pacing. And, you know, he knows me so well, and he can be that trusted ear that I know he has. He's so brilliant. He's still brilliant, you know.
It's really cool because it allows you to look through a different lens or listen through a different lens, as it may be.
Sometimes he would offer me criticism, but he also has a great balance. He also knew when to look at me and be like, that was good. That's not quite what I did, but I like that.
Even when he's not there, you know, I felt his presence. Like, I felt, you know, and I probably will now. I'll never forget the lessons he was teaching me.
And be like a kind of a Quincy Jones, where you can stand back and look at it like you are a record producer or even a fan. I get to fine tune, but I allow people a lot of freedom to change the arrangements. And everybody's way into anything that's a little bit different, because without change, you just stand still. You know, you're moving backwards. I just sit there and kind of go, give everybody thumbs up, sounds great, next tune. Oh, yeah.
My job is one of the most fun jobs to have, because what I get to do when I'm actually not singing a line is I get to watch, you know, and the up close. And these guys are incredible. I mean, every single one of them, you know, to just watch their hands and see what they do. It's amazing. So I think that one of the reasons the fans love Toto is that.
I work with a lot of singers, and I rarely see that kind of control and consistency.
Joe is brilliant on all levels. Your name will touch my lips like prayer. Hold the Line, I love, because that was one of the first songs I wrote when I moved away from home and got an apartment. And I got a little upright piano. And the first thing that I started playing was the riff, you know. Playing that riff, and I must have played it for 3 days. Hold the line.
Love isn't always on time. I really enjoy playing Hold the Line. Like, there's just this amazing spirit behind the song.
Luke looked over at me in one of the songs, I can't remember, I think it was Hold the Line, he was like, yeah.
The band has given me an opportunity to write songs with you know, a couple of some of the greatest songwriters on the planet.
Warren Ham, I first met prior to the Toto days, because his brother Bill was the guitar player in the Sonny and Cher rhythm section with myself, Jeff Porcaro, and David Hungate.
Warren has never played the wrong shit, and he's never sung the wrong shit. Like, that dude is he just does it right.
Every band in the world needs Warren Ham. Plays anything and sings his ass off.
Huge asset to the band vocally and instrumentally, and he's also one of the sweetest guys on earth.
My favorite one to perform is a song that Bobby Kimball wrote called You Are the Flower, which was from the very first record.
That was my favorite one to play.
One of my very favorite Toto songs, one of my very favorite vocal performances. Bobby Kimball was one of my very favorite singers when I was young, you know, when the band came out. I wanted to do the song in this particular show just because I love it so much, but also just as a way to, you know, just tell the audience that we love him and we don't forget how great he was. And he was the guy, you know, he was the Sean Connery of this band, you know what I mean? So, you know, this is my way of just, you know, reminding people of that and singing what to me is one of the best Toto songs out there.
A lot of older players who are accomplished, they don't reach that point anymore in their playing where they're on stage and it just takes them away. Like, it's just about the gig. But Luke is a rare musician in that it literally takes him away. Till the end, we'll be the ones who hold the key to a life that's open. Oh, yeah. Till the End is a great song that feels good to just play. It's hard and it's tough and it's edgy.
I think Rosanna best represents where the band was at by that time in history. And I think it has a little bit of everything. Not quite again since she went away. Rosanna. A lot of it was motivated by my first girlfriend that I had in high school. And one day, Steve Beccaro came walking in the house because he was staying at my place at the time. And he brought a girl through and introduced her, and her name was Rosanna. And it was Rosanna Arquette. I was just the name I was looking for to hook it. My dad had done an album with Ray Charles featuring all girls' names. So I thought, wow, this would be kind of trendy or hip to follow in the footsteps. And so I called it Rosanna, and I already had those chords there. All I had to do was place that name on top, and it magically fit. Parts of it that paid a tribute to the Philly sound in our B section, which we tip our hats to that amazing sound. It has great vocals, great performances, and an outro that's like second line gumbo playing that we did for the cats and the kittens out there. You know, the year we won Rosanna was record of the year. The first guy to stand up was Elton John, gave us a standing applause. And who's been my mentor ever since high school? Elton John, and that was incredible, you know, for us.
One of my favorite memories from both the rehearsal and the live stream is just singing with the dudes, man. Such a card game! Woo! I really love playing White Sister. That one's really fun.
My favorite song to perform would probably be White Sister.
The song is just a rocker, right? And then you get these great vocal stacks, and I'm playing synth stuff in between. Do you love me, White Sister?
He's my favorite guitar player.
No,
and he knows it too. And all you have to do is watch us on stage and watch what I'm doing when I'm not singing and he's playing.
Stop Loving You is one of my favorite songs. I get to play alto sax and percussion on that.
I'm feeling more comfortable in my skin than ever, you know, as far as music goes, and just looking back on the whole, how very blessed we were as a band to have made it this far, and how we keep growing as musicians, and the fact that we're all still friends.
What would you do if I sang out of tune? Would you stand up and walk out?
This is a beautiful song to begin with, but I think it really, the meaning of the song really stands out for after a year like 2020.
The lyrics are great, and the message is great. You know, Ringo's message is love and peace. Simple, but profound.
Back in the day when we had our high school band, one of the first songs I ever arranged for that high school band was Little Help from My Friends. I got to arrange it. So we used it as a closing song back then in high school to some of our concerts, because we loved the Joe Cocker version so much. And the Beatles were, you know, Sgt. Pepper, it's my favorite album.
You can't get through life the way that I think most people will want to get through life without friends.
That song, man, is just, I think it's hitting home a lot more now than ever, you know. And it's, I feel lucky to live in a world that, you know, we do have FaceTime and Messenger and video chatting and all that kind of stuff, so you can connect, even though it's not, you know, as good as being in the room with people. I mean, that's how we make it through everything, is with each other, man. Like, we're social creatures, you know. You can play all the music you want by yourself, but you get in a room with other dudes to play, or, you know, other people to play, and that's where the magic happens.
And you need help from other people. And also, you know, sometimes you will lose yourself and you can't pull yourself out of that hole. And having your friends there and having people who know you and know who you were, but also know who you have the potential to be, but also know exactly where you are. Having people who have those three different perspectives about you, past, present, and future, that's something that you can't really put into words in terms of how necessary it is, because, you know, people are necessary, you know. On every level of your life, people are necessary. And the minute that you forget that is the minute that you're lost.
Well, Little Help My Friends is something we, you know, we used to play the Joe Cocker version in high school and stuff like that, you know. The message of it, me working with Ringo, the times we live in, the fact that I was able to put together a band in 10 days, that we were able to do that and pull it off and pull off this monstrosity, you know, an idea, which we had no idea how difficult it would be until we got into it and how expensive it would be. But it was worth every penny.
The world needs healing right now, so I think it's an apropos closer to the show.
For me, who's been playing this stuff since I was a teenager, you know. So, I mean, I feel great about our choices, and I think we got a big future, given the opportunity, depending on God please bless us, we can get these vaccines out and get back to work.
Going a year, almost a year without playing on a stage, that was gratifying enough for me, you know. And then for it to be on that level with this group of people was even extra, you know, icing on top, so.
It's been an uphill battle, so our success is sweet, you know, that we can taste it again. You know, how many bands get a second shot like this? You know?
And we've spent the last year working together, you know, incredibly closely, almost on a daily basis.
I have a big future. It's planned out, tours booked, tickets on sale, band ready. Just got to rehearse a little bit more, puff up the set, and brush the cobwebs off, and we're good to go.
You know, our relationship, I think, is a strong one that's going to keep us working together and keep us going for quite some time.
I have two choices. How much time do I have left on Earth? How do I want to live it? And who do I want to live it with?
You know, God willing, you know, we'll be back and able to experience things as we knew them.
Having the opportunity to do what we did took me out of a rut, and then to be able to sing songs that you can register or relate to, that resonates with you or your spirit and your soul and the time and everything that's going on. It was definitely a help, a lifter.
Just be on stage with these gentlemen in front of a crowd, you know, regardless of the size, but knowing these guys, it's gonna be some pretty epic shows. So I'm pumped, man. I'm ready for whatever gets thrown my way.
I hope it's sooner than later, because people are ready to get out, go to a show.
I think the thing I miss most is just hugging people and being around people, mass gatherings, and not being afraid. There is a sense of fear that I cannot wait to be diminished.
Live music is really touches people.
I'm real excited about it. I think the new band is infused with a lot of energy. And if, you know, God willing, we'll all stay healthy and get the vaccine and move on into 2021 and beyond that, you know, and do more great things with Toto. I'm really looking forward to it.
I'm just looking forward to, you know, the opportunity to be able to go back and to just grow together and the music get better and better and better. Our camaraderie and our chemistry grow and get better and better. Yeah, I'm looking forward to that.
It just feels great to keep hearing our music and to know that people are out there still love us. And we're so in debt to our fans and friends and relatives for supporting us all these years. And it's just fantastic.
People are not going to never go see music again, you know, even if they have to wear hazmat suits.
It looks very promising, the future. Post-COVID, knock on wood that this horrible pandemic finds an end.
The band is all locked and loaded, ready to go. Luke and I we know the theme of our next few years. You know what I'm saying? So we're really kind of ready to go.
And God bless everybody.
Are we done?
We are done.